Thank you, choir. Also want to, when we did our prayer time, also want to think about those of our membership that are fighting the flu, fighting sickness, those that are traveling. I know that Jason is traveling today, and I know that Sherry and Frank are traveling, probably finding it very hard, Sherry and Frank are, to leave warmer climates to come home. So please pray for those that you don't see here this morning. And maybe those that couldn't get out of their houses this morning because of ice and snow and that sort of thing. Lynn, do we have any, I know we're supposed to have a baby shower on Saturday. What's the new date? February 10th at 2 o'clock. We changed because we were unsure about weather and we didn't want Jenna bringing Madeline out in that kind of weather, so we changed the baby shower date to them. Well, today's scripture comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verses 29 through 31. This is what I mean, brothers and sisters. The appointed time has grown very short. From now on, let those who have wives live as though they have none, and those who mourn as though they were not mourning, and those who rejoice as though they were not rejoicing, and those who buy as though they had no goods, and those who deal with the world as though they had no dealings with it. For the present form of this world is passing away. Thank you for God's holy and written word this morning. I want to come down and be with you this morning. As I said when you called me as your pastor, they said, preacher, well, you guys didn't, but somebody asked me my preaching style. And I said, I'm sort of a Methodist. Meaning I can be in a pulpit or I can walk and be close. Would you pray with me this morning? Almighty God, by grace alone you call us and accept us in your service. We ask that you strengthen us by your Spirit and make us worthy of your call through Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord. Amen. The best way for me to describe this morning's text. Hi, Johnny, how are you? You know, Jesus is coming back real quick. I'm not going to do nothing about it. It is what it is. Just going to rest on my laurels and wait for Jesus to come back. Is that okay? Johnny says no, so I better get up. And this is what the Apostle Paul is talking about this morning. How many in this congregation, you know, we talk about Jesus coming back, but how many people think that Jesus coming back is closer and closer? Closer than it was yesterday. Closer than it was the day before. And as we said, it could be in our lifetime, 100 years from now, or it could be in that blink. And what Paul is telling these people this morning is you can't stop. You got to keep doing what you're doing. Yes, you can't wait for Jesus because Jesus has expectations for us until he does come back. Is it okay for me to say, and this is farthest from the truth, so don't believe this. Oh, I'm the most perfect there is. Jesus is going to grab me first. I'm just going to lay here. You know, I used to work with a guy that said, you know, I know Jesus is coming back. I'm getting a six-pack of Coke, and I'm sitting on the roof. Well, how long of a wait does he have, and how much Coke does he have to drink? See, one of the most important things that Paul is talking about this morning is how do we act? Who are we? And who has God made us to be, called us to be? And what does God expect us to be? Does God have expectations for his people? And what are these expectations that we should be doing until Christ comes back? Ephesians 4, 25 through 32 tells us the following. Therefore, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to your neighbor, for we are all members of one body. In your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you are still angry. How many married couples have heard that? Do not go to sleep angry. And do not give the devil a foothold. I like that one. Anyone who has been stealing must not steal any longer, but must work doing something useful with their own hands that they may have something to share with those in need. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths. I like how they word that, unwholesome talk. What do you think they're meaning, unwholesome talk? But only what is helpful for building up others according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Get rid of all bitterness, rage, and anger, brawling and slander, among with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other just as Christ has forgiven you. You know that you and I have been sealed in Jesus Christ, that you and I belong to him, and we're pretty much in good shape. But what does that mean? Does that mean that we should just sit down and not worry about anything? Or what do we do now? We have this safety and protection of being God's sealed people. What does that mean? Does that mean, well, that's good for me? Heck with everybody else. I'm good to go. Are we going to be like the church at Corinth that just said, Jesus loves me, this I know. He loves me, this I know. I'm good to go. So, you know, come on, Jesus, anytime. Or, yes, I am sealed in the blood of Christ, but I got work to do. My friends, what the Scripture is telling us this morning is that our first and most important call as Christians is by living as a Christian. And this is done by living lives that are ethical. You heard me ask the kids about ethical this morning. All of us that have accepted God's call to a personal relationship with Jesus Christ have first and foremost been called to loving others as Christ loves us and as Christ loves the church. This ethical living must be understood in the context that the Apostle Paul did not disapprove of marriage or social institutions, but he wants us to live ethical lives that are in motion, lives that are in present anticipation of God's future, which even now has dawned through the death and resurrection of Jesus . This ethical living must be understood in the context that Paul wrote. Anybody in Sunday school this morning, did we talk about context and how to understand the word? Who was Paul writing for? What was going on? What was the time? Who were the people that he was writing to? Well, you and I are Christians, and this is the faith life that we have chosen. This Christian call that we have answered tells us that the old life must be given away for a new life and new ways of living. For us to call ourselves followers of Christ, we must live in anticipation of Christ's return, but we must also live our lives as if this return has already begun. When's Jesus coming back? Don't know. But he's on his way. He is making preparations for the return. It is in action. It is in God's head when it's going to happen. So we as Christians must live our lives not if it's going to happen, but it's going to happen. And we have work to do until we hear those trumpets in the sky. Beloved, there is a cycle of God's call for our lives. I read an article when I was preparing this message. It was by Melissa Lauber, and she wrote in a 2011 article in Ministry Matters magazine. And it gives the five cycles of following God's call for our lives. If you saw that, you see that cell phone? And it says, God's calling. And it says, will you answer? Or, what is your answer? While some people sense their calling like a lightning bolt sent straight from God, most go through a series of steps, a cycle of discernment and action, and these are the steps. You see, Paul is saying, Christ is coming back, he is on his way, but get up and do something about it. He doesn't want you there just lying and waiting for him. We have work to do. We have an ethical life to live. And what does this mean for our lives? When we live lives that are ethical, honest, and true, and loving, do I need to say, add Jesus, 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 Jesus? Or do you see God in the way that I live my life? Do I have to mention Jesus every other word? Or how I live my life by loving others, do you see Christ in me? And that's the work that God is calling us to. This is what Paul is talking about this morning. You and I have work to do. Even though we're comfortable knowing Christ is going to return, don't get comfortable, because we have to help make other people ready. So when Christ calls on us, what are these cycles? First of all, God gives us a revelation. And this revelation is when you get a clear glimpse of what God is calling you to do. You ever had that happen? Hey, there's a new Sunday school class. Maybe I should go. I like that. Church is at 10:45. Maybe I should go. Something like that. Or maybe it's something that God has planned for you to do in your life, in the lives of people you know, or in the lives of strangers. And then there's resistance, a phase filled with doubt and questions. How many times in Scripture do we see God call prophets? How many times did we see him call some fishermen and they said, hey, you got the wrong guy, you got the wrong guys. We're not who you're calling. We're asking questions and we're asking ourselves, why me? He can't be talking to me. It's like that old movie, you talking to me? Are you talking to me? And then the third one is commission. God's voice becomes clearer and you feel compelled to respond. What has God been saying to you? And it has become repetitive, and now you need to respond. How are you going to respond to God's call? And then there's partnership. A time when your call begins to fit into the church or in other ministries, and your call becomes part of your community's call. What is God calling you to in ministry within the community, within your church family? Is there any work to do in the church? Do we have any ministry for you here in the church? What can you do in the church? And I'm not talking about in this building. We are the church. You are the church. We are the church together. What do? For each other. Until Christ comes back. And what do we do for the world around us? And then finally, service. You move into action, bringing God's call to life. Isn't that something? I love that. How do we bring God's call for our lives to life? How do we give it life? Let us take these five cycles of God's call for our lives and let's focus on how and what this means for us in living ethical lives of love and service to others. You see, each one of these cycles is much more than a job or a mission calling. It's a way of living our lives. You see, we cannot be the Saturday evening sinner and the Sunday morning saint. This ethical living that we're called becomes us. It becomes part of our nature, how we live and how we breathe and how we act. When we get a glimpse of God calling us, we get a glimpse of how our lives must be changed because Christ has forever changed our lives. So when we get this call from God that we answer, we must be changed. And that's a changed life. We're made anew. How many times in the Bible do we hear anew? I will make you a new thing. You'll be baptized. You'll be made anew. Do we see a theme going here? When you answer God's call, you are made anew. Evil will occasionally cause us resistance to ethical living. These are choices that each of us face daily and must understand that we have answered God's call. And when God calls us, evil must decrease as our new lives in Christ increase. By being in God's Word and retaining a prayer life relationship with God, we can keep the connection of His call open as to openly understand as to be life-sustaining. You see when that phone rings? When we have a prayer life, the line is always open. You don't have to call God. That line of communication is always open when we have an active relationship and prayer life with God. When living an ethical life, we understand the partnership that we have formed as the people of God's church and the partnership that we have in our communities and the world around us. First and foremost, ethical lives in Christ are in service to others. First and foremost is how we treat and how we respect humanity, people around us. Who's going to work in the morning? Well, it's Martin Luther King Day, so we're off tomorrow. So who's going to work on Tuesday? How do we treat the people around us? How do we treat the people around us? My friends, our expectations of God's call for our lives begin at home with our husbands and our wives and our children and family. You see, we have a responsibility, a Christian responsibility, whether Christ returns in 100 years or 100 seconds. The lives that we live, the lives that we lead, must be Mark 1:15 lives. If you want to write this on your bulletin, Mark 1:15. The time has come, he said. The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news. Your life has changed. Lead lives and live lives of the good news, new lives that are ethical lives, that show the good news, that live the good news, that promote the good news, that have children where you can see good news in the children. You see, this ethical life, we also have a responsibility to humanity and how we pass along this ethical living. Do we have a responsibility to our children to teach them how to be ethical people? Do we have responsibility to the world around us on how to be ethical people, how to read ethical life? You see, we learned this in Sunday school this morning. God calls us to lead ethical lives, lives of order. And this life we lead through Jesus Christ is a life that brings order instead of chaos. Is it nice to live an orderly life rather than one that's always in chaos? Yes, the Lord is coming. But we, like the church at Corinth, must not stop, must not slow down. We must continue to love our spouses. We must continue to love and raise our children. We must suppress grief and live joy and must not ignore the people and the world around us. You see, we have a call, and His name is Jesus Christ, and He is coming. He is on His way. Do not let the world dictate your lives, but rather let the world see that Jesus Christ, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, dictates your lives and that he is on his way. Do not be controlled by the world, but rather embrace God and the loving direction that he has given our lives. Author and theologian Eugene Peterson wrote the following in his book, The Message. Dear, dear Corinthians, I can't tell you how much I long for you to enter this wide open, spacious life. We didn't fence you in. The smallness you feel comes from within you. Your lives aren't small, but you are living them in a small way. Open up your lives. Live openly and expansively. Carrollton Christian Church, your lives aren't small, but you may be living them in a small way. Open up your lives. Live openly and expansively. Don't rest and wait for Jesus to come. Go out and be the people and take the call that God has called you to. I leave you with this today. Live your lives openly. Never be afraid or embarrassed of God's call on your life. Never let the world fence you in from living and leading ethical lives of faith. Open your lives to the world as God's people and let them see your happiness so they can experience their own godly call in their lives. And there's a guy on Facebook that I told my Sunday school class that I've been following, and he says, they tried to steal my Jesus. Don't let anybody ever try to steal your Jesus or his call for your life. This is God's word for today. Amen.